by Media Lab in the Aalto Arts and then the Media Factory of Aalto University. Good to see all of you here, and also those of you who are watching the stream, welcome. Today we will be talking about puzzles, which is kind of an old thing, already been around for thousands of years. But now Jaakko Kemppainen, who's a game designer at Mindfield and also graduated from the game design and production masters here at Aalto. He has now been working on Pollen and in the virtual reality setting. So it's really interesting to see how this dynamic between this old thing of puzzles that have been there forever and how that works together with virtual reality, how this connection works. But welcome, Jaakko. Just go for it.
Thank you. Yeah, it's really interesting to see for me too, because I don't know, but let's see. Okay, here's like today's agenda. First, I'll tell you a little bit who I am and why I am here. And then we go a little bit through like kind of theory and what is a puzzle let's say those like things related to puzzles and how they are built and so on. And of course, since I'm working in Mindfield Games and we are making the game Pollen, I kind of have to have that Pollen here. So we are going to take a look on Pollen and then maybe analyze those puzzles there a little bit. Then go to narratives and puzzles and realism. And in the end, we'll take a like brief look at the possibilities of virtual reality as a puzzle environment. So, who am I? I'm Jaakko Kemppainen, as Mick already told you. I'm lead game designer at Mindfield Games. I've been working there for 7 months now. So I came to the like Pollen project a bit late, but yeah, it has been quite interesting still. I graduated from Media Lab game design program last year, and I have been making games for a living and also teaching them, researching them for almost 14 years. I started with those SMS TV games, you know, you send a text message and then you can play mini golf on TV broadcast, and now we are making virtual reality games, so it's like always something a bit different from the mainstream. I participated in something like more than 20 published games from pen and paper, RPGs, SMS TV, mobile games, browsers, console, and now we are working on PC game for virtual reality devices. So quite a lot of different platforms and also a lot of different genres, like really hardcore strategic casual games, puzzles, and so on. And that might be because my battle gamer type, if you know these like gamer types, I'm an explorer, and I also like to explore these like different projects, different game mechanics and genres and so on. So maybe for that reason, I've been changing my place a lot and trying always to find something new and trying out different things. And yeah, my brain hex is something like mastermind slash sleeker or seeker achiever. So that also might tell someone something about like why I do what I do and so on. Well, maybe we should continue with this question, like what is a puzzle? Here are a couple of screens from recent and not so recent puzzle games. And as you can see, they are really different from each other. So I studied this subject for my thesis. I wrote my thesis about like puzzle design and especially on knowledge-based puzzles, which means like the player actually has to go outside the game world to the real world to search for information, so he can actually progress in the game. So it's kind of, I don't know, it goes towards augmented reality or augmented virtuality or something like that. And while writing the thesis, I of course was thinking quite a lot of this puzzle thing. And well, here's one definition of this, like where the puzzle kind of goes. It's not a story because stories don't have interaction. It's not a toy because toys don't have goals. You just play with them. But of course, you can make kind of games and you can decide your own goals with the toys. But the toys themselves, they don't have these kind of goals. In like strict definition, puzzles are not also games because puzzles don't have like kind of winning conditions. Or there's no competition in puzzles. There might be people compete against each other somehow, but competition is not built inside the puzzles themselves. So puzzles have goals; they don't have like a competition, and they are somehow interactive. Yeah, and a couple of more shots from puzzles and puzzling experiences. So I would say puzzles have rules for actions and ending conditions. If you think about, let's say Sudoku, for example, there are rules, like you have to put the numbers in some order. And then there is an ending condition. So when you have the like filter squares with the numbers and there are no errors there, then it's like solved. So puzzles have one or more solutions. And that's a different from, let's say, from football also. Like you actually don't know. When the football game starts, you play for, I don't know, 90 minutes or something. And then you see how it went. But with puzzles, you just figure out, you either solve it or then you don't solve it. If you don't solve it, then you can continue trying out until you finally solve it. Or then you can leave it and go to doing something else. Puzzles are often kind of mental challenges rather than dexterity, force or senses-based challenges. Well, there can be kind of like time limits or the timing required in puzzles, but usually the like pressure is more on the like mental challenge side. And element of uncertainty is usually quite non-existent. The puzzle is solved or it's not. Actually, some puzzles sometimes they have some random elements, so there's like might be like uncertainty of is it actually solvable? For example, if you make a Sudoku and add some random numbers in a grid, it might be, it looks like Sudoku, but it might be it's not possible to solve that. So, well, you can actually ask, is it even a puzzle then, or is it just like some nonsense? And competing is possible, but usually it's not embedded in the puzzle itself. But people can calculate the time, how long it took to solve the puzzle, or how many moves it took from players to solve the puzzle and give like points or put the people in like order that way. But the competition is not built in the puzzle itself. And of course, puzzles are often used as elements of other games. I think quite many of you have played some like old school adventure games from Sierra or LucasArts, like Monkey Island. And well, there are like puzzles in the game. You have to find the key for a door, or you have to get some item and use it in right place so you can progress in the game. You can also argue that those games per se, they are puzzles because you actually try to figure out what the designer has been thinking. They are not necessarily like games where you just try to like play the world, but you have to understand the mindset of the designer. And of course, historically, many puzzles have been like physical artifacts or objects in the real world. From the history, you know all this like jigsaw puzzles, for example, and these made of wood things like pirunyrkki in Finnish, I don't know what's it in English. They are also puzzles. And people have made this kind of like things for hundreds of years, maybe thousands of years, like just to entertain themselves, give other people some challenge, and somehow like maybe like being playful and spend some time also. Puzzles can also be something that is not explicitly defined, and I would call this like puzzling experiences. So if you find something like abandoned stuff in the forest, like in the middle of nowhere, you see a car and some stuff. It's like, oh, what has happened here? And who did it? When did it happen? And is this actually a business for treasure hunters, or should I call police? So your mind starts to work like, okay, I want to understand what has happened there. And that can be understood as a like puzzle or puzzling experience. But it's not explicitly defined. It's not designed as a puzzle. So it might be that there is no, like, you can never find a solution or understand the events over there. Also, quite many games, when you go, for example, to Steam and look at the, like, puzzle genre games there, they don't quite fit to the like previous definition like this. Like, there are rules for actions, they have one or more solutions, especially those solution things, like they are like really problematic with like digital puzzles and puzzle games, because what is like when have you found the solution for Tetris? Like, you play the Tetris, which is called as a puzzle game, you play it until you fail. And that raises a question: is it actually a puzzle, or is it just a game where you use your mental abilities and try to form these like horizontal lines and so on? And a lot of casual games and also mobile games are sold as puzzles, but they're kind of something else. But that's because culture changes, language develops, and people tend to apply old terms and phenomena in new ways. The digital puzzles are quite new when you think about like the puzzle games. They have like thousands of years of history, and now there have been digital puzzle games for 30 years or something. So people like to use these genre names in different ways, and also, well, one reason is that genres are used as marketing devices. So if you want to have like large audience, you of course you want to give your or put your game in under various different genres, so people who are searching for new games, they can find them from many different places. So, well, definitions of puzzles are a bit vague. Also applies to all the other games and genres too. Well, this is quite obvious. Puzzles rely on like different traits of people. It can be a puzzle can be like special navigation, perception. For example, in Legend of Grimrock or Dungeon Master, you have to like find yourself through a maze, and then you have to be like really careful when you are looking around, so you actually can spot all those keys and little items which you use in the game, so you can progress there. Pattern matching logic are quite common in puzzles. Like, yeah, you have to. Sometimes there are some levers or things that you have to like pull in correct order, and maybe there are some also like a Boolean logic behind those levers. Something like that. Of course, Newtonian physics, I don't know, Angry Birds, it's like kind of puzzle game. You can solve all those levels. Like there is like a kind of optimal solution, but the puzzle is like you have to try to find it out. But if you are not like, you cannot do that well, then you can try to like use your time kind of brute force yourself through the level. Time manipulation nowadays quite common, you know, Reset, the Swapper, different games use time manipulation and cooperation with yourself and so on. mathematics words, really classical puzzles and riddles also. Word puzzles are you often called as riddles. But yeah, colors, music, art, knowledge-based puzzles, that's something that I was really interested in, because it's kind of, I was playing this puzzle game called Time Hunt maybe 15 years ago, and basically you had to go search for information from internet and books and so on if you wanted to progress in the game, and the game was actually working as kind of pointer. It showed you interesting things in the world, and when you went there and started searching for information, you started like, oh, this is interesting, and suddenly you see find out that, oh, I lost 3 hours. I was reading something completely different and forgot the game, and it was excellent. Yeah, of course, some dexterity, motoric skills, time, rhythm, everything else is quite often present in puzzles. But lateral thinking, kind of thinking outside of the box, it's the like essence and the bestest thing of puzzles. Like, you actually have to like think like completely different, like find some new angle to the like problem. And those are like really fun when you finally find the solution for the puzzle. But yeah, I have been, after my thesis, I've been thinking a lot about these puzzles, and I've been kind of developing a model or theory about puzzles. And now I think the basis for the theory could be that all puzzles are locks. You can argue that you don't have to agree with me, because this is like still under construction, but let me explain this and show you some examples of this thing. So I think all puzzles can be seen as combinations of lock, key, and action. Of course, there are some other elements in puzzles. We will look at them a bit later. But variations in order of these like things and importance and weighting of those kind of give the basis and sub-genre for the puzzle. For example, this is like, of course, quite obvious. Like, you have a locked door in an adventure game, and well, you have to find the key. So there's the lock and key, and the action is you actually have to go and move around the surroundings, use your perception, try to find the key which fits the lock. And that's the action of this like really simple lock, key, and action puzzle. And a lot of these like adventure games and role-playing games, they have puzzles like this, and sometimes it feels like, are there these even puzzles, because they are so obvious and they kind of belong so well to the world. But if you think about this, for example, in this picture, there's a lock over there somewhere. And when you put the key in there, this force field disappears, and then you can get the object behind. And in this special, especially this case, you find the lock first. So you actually know that there has to be a key for this. And then you have the lock, then you go search for the key. And when you find the key, you actually then can go back there and use the key there. Or if you have a similar lock somewhere else, then you have to decide on like on which lock I want to use this key, because it's also like a matter of choice. Sometimes you are given the key first, like, okay, I have a key, now I have to find the lock. So then you go and maybe play as normal, and when you find the door, then you know, okay, I'll try this key to the lock, and then you unlock the door and can progress. So this kind of variation on the order of presenting the lock and key to the players already gives some variation to puzzles. Yeah, another Finnish example, parcel, where you use two guys or robots, or later on there might be even four. I don't know, I have only two of them now. And you have to get like the parcel box to the yellow area where the yellow beam of light is. And the key is like the rules of movement and actions, actions of enemies. So you know how this world works, and then you have to, like, your action is try out working in this world and try to figure how you can actually get to the parcel, to the ending point. And you can do that by like trying everything, building slowly forward in this game, or then you can like sit down and look at the puzzle and think about the like solution, and when you think you have found it, then you can just implement it on the game and see how it goes. This is like kind of problematic game genre. It's like I call them action puzzles, or maybe there should be something else, because for example, this Best Fiends game, it doesn't have like time limits. You can use all the time you want to like try out and so on. So if you don't do anything, the game waits your actions. So it's kind of, maybe it's not an action puzzle, but it's the lock is like level setup and winning condition. In this picture, you have to destroy two more slugs and, I don't know, find or destroy six more those mushrooms and collect four drops of water. So that's kind of the setup. And the key is to connect the similar symbols, like which are adjacent to each other's, and then they disappear and new ones come down. But this is puzzle is like really heavily like focusing on the action. You already know how it looks like. Well, what is the lock? You already know what is the key. And when you play the game, you actually like repeat the action over and over again, like dozens or maybe even hundreds of times on each level. So no, maybe not hundreds of times, and dozens, 70 something moves can be used in some levels. So it can be solved. You, when you achieve those goals, it's like, yeah, I solved this puzzle. But the like element of uncertainty is strong with this one. at least I feel like quite many times the levels cannot be solved. That's like you play the game as long as you can, and you are this close to like getting through the level and getting to the next level, and then you fail. But that's of course because then you can buy some more rounds, and then you can continue playing. So there's a reason for this kind of almost unsolvable puzzle thing. But is this even a puzzle? I'm starting to think like, no, they are not. They are puzzle-like games, or they are games that have puzzle elements or something like that. But as I told you, it's like theory is still under construction, so I have to think about this a little bit more. Fourth example, RGB Express. There are cars, there are boxes. You have to use the cars to bring the boxes to the like same colored buildings, and you draw lines on the screen on mobile phone. And each package should be in the similar colored building. And I think you have to use the similar colored car to do that. And then you know how you can move there. And the action is like you draw the route for the cars, and then you press play, and then you see what happens. So this is kind of a puzzle which you can look at and completely solve it before doing any actions in the game. And that's like really interesting difference between, like, for example, this one, where you are, most of the time you are playing, you are repeating the action. But in this game, most of the time thinking about the like solution. Yeah, well, of course, besides being lock key and action, there's a reward. What happens after the puzzle, after solving that? If it's like single shot, it's like Sudoku or some other jigsaw puzzle, it's like, okay, it's completed, forget it, let's go forward. Sometimes it opens a door to the next area, or you can play the next level of the puzzle game or something like that. And also it can give you a part of a key to another puzzle. So there are kind of nesting puzzles in many role-playing and adventure games. But then open-ended puzzles can be problematic. Like you actually don't know if you have solved it. The designers or writers or whoever they are, they give you hints and you might like think, okay, there's like a puzzle or there's a, like something I don't actually understand. And then your key is to like, or your action is to try to understand the thing and find more clues. And the clues are keys for the problem. But sometimes the designers just don't tell you if you have solved the puzzle. So it remains open-ended. And then you kind of lose the feeling of achievement of like solving the puzzle. But also it leaves you hopefully thinking like what this could be. And you start building up like your own ideas of what does this actually mean and how could this be solved and so on. So it also can live a bit longer in your mind. Yeah, well, besides being locks, I was already talking about this, like can the puzzle be solved by thinking before performing the action? Yeah, for example, in this RPG, let's go forward. Does it actually require doing stuff? For example, in this Legend of Grimrock, you cannot just sit down and think about the puzzle because the key doesn't appear here. You have to play the game, go and search for the key. So basically, you leave the lock behind, you go somewhere else in the game, but you still are inside the game world and you try to find the lock and the key. And when you find the key, then you come back and then you can unlock the lock. Many times you can be kind of brute forcing the thing. You go everywhere, you try every possible solution there. For example, If you have a like password or like a number lock or something, you can actually start brute forcing. Try every possible combination, and at some point you can go through. And you don't have to find a proper solution from the game, but you can kind of break the game. And maybe the solution is trivial, like in Best Fiends and Tetris and other similar games, I know this is the lock and this is like how the key works, and then I just repeat over and over again the same action. Is it even a puzzle? I don't know. But okay, let's go a bit deeper in this puzzle thing. It's puzzles can be clear or self-sufficient, I say. It's the puzzle itself contains all the information the player needs to solve the puzzle. So for example, this game puzzle from Legend of Grimrock, there are like those spikes going in a certain pattern around that labyrinth or maze. And then you just observe the pattern for a while, and then you know, okay, this is how it should be done, and then you can get past those spikes because you understand the internal kind of workings of the puzzle. But puzzles can also be enigmatic. It's they don't tell you what is the key, what is needed. They don't even tell you this is a lock. You are presented something, and then you're like, okay, should I start solving this? How does this work? You don't know. And sometimes this trying to figure out what is the key is like a really big part of the puzzle. And maybe you start like clicking different items and find out something happens, and then you can kind of build a model inside your head. What that means. Sometimes puzzles require external information. You have to go somewhere. It gives you a hint about, I don't know, Cipher Folio 13 or something, and then you go Google and it's like, oh, it's like an order of golden branch, whatever, and then you can use that as a password in the game. And so it requires you to go outside of the game world to search for new information. Of course, maybe you have to ask, like, what does this mean? Puzzles can be definitive. It's like player knows when the puzzle is solved. Maybe player can try to find some alternative solution for it. But well, it's always clear. Okay, it's solved and done. Or then the puzzles can be open-ended. Like player feels like I don't know if I already know the answer for this puzzle. I know what this means. And these like open-ended puzzles and puzzling experiences, not necessarily only in games, they are like kind of subjective interpretation. It's like the player or the watcher or reader has to like think about what does this mean and what does it mean to me also. For example, the ending of Space Odyssey 2001. Does someone know what the ending means? Hands up. No, okay. But it's wonderful, it's excellent, even if we don't know what it means. And I think every one of us has kind of like own interpretation of the like meaning of the like last sequence of the film. Game of Homesick, like indie game, someone sometimes called as like walking simulator. Yeah, I don't know about the story, what it means, but yeah, I solved the game, I played it through. And of course this classic, like, why is Raven like a writing desk? yeah, does someone know why is a Raven like a writing desk? This is actually from Alice in Wonderland, or the other book, but yeah. It has been bustling people for, I don't know, 100 years or something, and we still don't know why it is. And we have like theories, we have interpretations, but we don't know what the writer or the designer actually meant, or did he even have a solution for it. It's like, yeah, this is great, let's keep the people busy for 100 years. So yeah, even designers and writers may not know the final solution of the puzzle sometimes. Oh, this is great. Puzzles are really good at disguising themselves. Like many strategy games, especially like lighter strategy games, like Great Little War Game, if someone has played it on mobile, they look like yes, this is a strategy game. I have to make decisions and build some strategies. But actually, there's like quite often like really clear that you have to do it actually exactly in like some order if you want to get through the levels. So. The levels are actually puzzles. It's not that side, but quite many game times in strategy games, you have to do like certain things in certain order to get through the levels. Also, as I told before, like many classical adventure games, actually the whole game is a puzzle. It's like you just try to understand like what did this designer think. How does this work? It doesn't necessarily make any sense, especially in the good old days of adventure games. The like, things in the game were really like, what? Like, yeah, put some like alarm clock in the like pea soup so you get a nuclear bomb or something like that. So, designers, beware. When you are making a system or a story, understand that sometimes it turns out to be a puzzle. So if there's like one solution for a strategy game or really dominant strategy in a strategy game, it feels more like a puzzle. For example, for a long time I was thinking that all these tower defense games, they were strategy games that you can try out different strategies and build your own way to defend your tower, but after playing them for a while, I found out that quite often you actually have to play like optimal game. You have to do like exact right things early in the game if you want to get through the like later levels. So they are not strategy games, they are puzzles. Yeah, that was about puzzles and theories, and now maybe we could talk a little bit about pollen. I will show you a video. Hopefully it works. We got through that already. Yeah, so what is pollen? Pollen is a first person exploration science fiction adventure. It's focused on Oculus and other VR devices like OSVR and later on also on
Hi.
Ha. Later on also on PlayStation VR and I don't know, whatever comes around. Oh yeah, of course, like HTC Vive, so basically Valve's and Steam's like own VR system. But it's also fully playable with normal PC and screen because, well, like the amount of those devices in the market is not high, especially not yet, because no like big device is on consumer market yet. The devices are coming out, starting to come out around Christmas, early next year, maybe quarter one next year. So that's why we are kind of planning our release date there. The game is made by Mindfield Games, based in Helsinki. We have 11 employees already. And yeah, Pollen went to Steam Greenlight maybe a month ago, not that much, might be a month ago, and got greenlit in about 36 hours. It's not a record, but it's still damn fast. Yeah, and you already saw the like gameplay trailer. You walk around, you use some devices, look at things, listen to audio tapes, and so on. So it's a story-driven adventure where the player ends up in a moon base on Saturnian moon Titan. His or her task is to try to understand what has happened on the station. It's like kind of a big question hanging in the air, like why is this place empty? We use environmental storytelling, like which means basically we use items and surroundings as storytelling devices. So there are like letters, books, audio tapes, also some other items, tools, and all the items and everything there, they have like a reason why they are in the world, and they tell a bit about like life on the station, what has happened to people, what has happened about like in general, and so on. But we are not making like walking and looking simulator, as maybe someone has played those games like Dear Esther. You just can walk around. I don't know, you can't even jump. You walk around in the game. It's kind of, yeah. But it's also like a puzzling experience, a kind of like puzzle. You go there, the like environment tells you something, and also the like voiceovers tell you something. But in the end, you have to figure out yourself, like what does it mean? Why I played through this game? Or is it even a game? I don't know. But we didn't want to make like just a walking and looking simulator, so we have some like traditional puzzle elements in the game. We have some usable machinery. You can actually do things in the world. You can play around. And well, the whole station is like really huge, or at least quite big physics sandbox where you can pick up all the little items. You can start like, I don't know, playing dominoes with books, throwing basketball. I don't know, whatever. Well, maybe we could look at like a couple of these puzzles and things we have in the game from the very beginning of the game, and all these things have been seen in videos we have released. So the gameplay trailer and earlier also Road to VR showed some gameplay, like raw gameplay material, and I'm not giving you any more spoilers. So, well, in the very beginning of the game, after maybe 15 to 20 minutes of playing, you get into this room, and the airlock behind you closes. And well, you can see there's something strange on the floor lying down there, and yeah, there's a red light or orange light on the door, and well, then you go forward, you start looking at like, oh, what is this? There's like overalls, and ID card, but what is inside overalls, and what does it mean? It's like, you start immediately thinking like, what does it mean? And also, what has happened here? We have also the traditional locked doors puzzle there. you find a door, but you cannot find the key in this room. Well, maybe that's not that traditional at all. But after walking around, examining some objects, something happens, and you get this visual effect you actually saw in the video earlier. And then you see that the surroundings change somehow. So maybe the, something happened, you changed to another time, another dimension, another place, or I don't know, someone just came here and changed the room. So now if you go back to the door, it's still, you cannot get through it, but it has changed. It's not locked anymore, there is no lock. It has changed. So maybe something else has also changed. So when you go around looking, kind of backtracking your way, you find like, okay, now you know how to get through the door and also like that. So in a couple of minutes, we give you quite many like simultaneous and layered puzzles. And like, why is the overall on the floor, and what is the black stuff over there? It's like, what? ID card. Maybe it can be used somehow. And how to get through the door? What happened to the surroundings, and why? It's like questions, puzzling experiences. Where to find the key to the door, and how this all connects and fits together. So, of course, locked door. It's like, lock is the lock. Well, there's a lock, and you have to find a way to open it. But you cannot find that key for the lock. So, as an action, you, of course, you first search for the room, you cannot find the lock, then you figure out, okay, maybe I have to do something else. And then you start looking at other items, and something happens. It's kind of called like principle of parallelism, which is really good in puzzles. So if the player kind of gets stuck somewhere, there should be a way that he can do something else and get progress from somewhere else. And we're actually kind of exploiting that principle. Of course, there's a solution. So the door opens, you get through the door. But and the solution exists in the game world. You don't have to go search for information in Google, unless you want to go to look for Let's Play videos, and then I actually don't understand the Let's Play videos, but well, I'm so old. Yeah, so there is a solution, but the solution can be delayed, and actually it can be done in quite an unexpected manner. I'm not telling you, but yeah, it's maybe something else than just a key. And of course, the reward is a progression in the game. You get to the new areas. And then another, overalls. It's like, is it a lock? Maybe it's a lock. It's a like mystery of empty overalls with dust, ash, or something else. Key is to like understand what has happened, and action is try to find more clues. But it can also be like a clue for a bigger puzzle. It's like, it might be a part of a, something huge. Lucky for you, developers know what this means and what has happened. So it's possible that we can give you like enough information and clues so you can actually also understand all these like events and what has happened there. But some questions may still remain open-ended because I think, yeah, okay, let's go back to that question later. And yeah, okay, another puzzle there. Rifting. It's like, yeah, you do something and then you get like nice fractal effects and stuff, and then the environment changes. And this serves many purposes. It's kind of lock because it opens up something new. You get kind of to new place there. And well, it's a lock, then the key is, of course, like how it is activated. And action is to do the action. Well, it's also key because it's part of a solution for another puzzle. And it's a clue for something bigger. And of course, it's a puzzling experience because it's something unexpected. You are doing like quite normal stuff and suddenly something happens. Like what? Yet again, another what. But yeah, of course. Well, now you can expect it to happen, so sorry for ruining this for you. But anyways, this is quite important. We are we the developers are not holding player's hand in the game, so the player may or may not understand everything in the game. You can play through the game, get to the ending, and still you may have found only like a couple of the clues, maybe 20% of all the like important items and clues in the game. So we give you some responsibility of your actions. We provide some clues, but the game may still remain open-ended. Okay, Pollen was is kind of a VR first game. It was designed as a good VR experience, virtual reality experience as possible nowadays. Since virtual reality is very immersive, the environment should be like highly detailed. This means like there are serial numbers in almost everything, a lot of like extra information in the game, and you can do quite a lot of different things, and all those little things, they have meaning in the world. So we think that immersion breaks quite easily if something doesn't work or is lazily implemented, so we have put a lot of effort in this like details. Also, we think that environment should be as interactive as possible, because when you are in the virtual reality, you feel like you are in the like game world, and then you see a glass on the table, and of course you want to like, okay, it's a glass on the table, I should be able to pick it up and drink or do something else. I think we, yeah, okay. Anyways, but if the game doesn't allow you to do that, it starts to feel artificial. It's like kind of like a movie prop. Yeah, I'm just visiting here. This is like made up. This is not real. And it kind of breaks the immersion. So there's a lot of like, I think we have hundreds of like items that you can interact with. And all the buttons and everything, you can press them. And most of them also have some actions. Also, in VR, you can't use cutscenes. You should not use non-diegetic voiceovers, meaning that no voices from outside of the game world. All the like sound should have a like 3D source in the world, because if there is no like 3D source in the world, you start hearing voices in your head, and it feels quite strange. Also, we cannot take the controls away from the player, because when you are in the virtual reality, if someone takes away from the control from you, it feels not good. And actually, it can cause some motion sickness and other like not so nice things. So what does it mean cause? Because we want it to be highly detailed, very interactive. It means like quite many times you end up looking at some tomato soup can, like, oh, this is the most amazing tomato soup can I've ever seen in games, and there are 300 of these in the world, wow. So of course it's great, but it's also like overwhelming, and it could be kind of frustrating, because there is so much thing you can do in the world. But well, Pollen is also a story. It was not made as a like adventure game, having like a lot of like puzzles, like, ooh, we have this fancy lock in this door and everything. But we want to tell a story, and the puzzles are just like small pieces of the story. All the puzzles in the game world need to be kind of believable, and they have to feel like they could exist in the game world. So we don't have these crazy mechanics in doors. Like, what is the point of like having something, I don't know, in a door you have to do things in correct order. This is only for clever people. All the stupid people should stay away. It feels really like Well, it's good for a game, but it's not really good for like story. There's kind of like narrative dissonance there. And of course, if a door is locked, there's always a reason for the, like, why is it locked? And there's always a way to lock and unlock the door. So we have had to think about these puzzles like in a way, like what has happened in the world. And if we wanted to have a locked door, we have to think about why is it locked, who has done it, and where it has been done. Because if the player can't find a way to like, lock the door, then it's like, right, maybe the people who lived here couldn't also do this. So we had to add some stuff in the game for unlocking and locking doors. The base is home for people. People do mundane things. They like cook food. They read books. They play games, and sometimes they get bored. And that should be like seen in the game world. And also the player is intruding the world. It is the game world is not made for the player. The player comes from outside to a world that has been like a living thing there. People have lived there, they have doing things. And player just comes there and sees what has happened, what people have been doing there. And of course, all this like caused some interesting challenges in puzzle and story design. And I hope we manage to tackle this interesting challenges in like good way. But yeah, there's story behind everything. There's a reason why there's this like camp you saw in the video, why the book is there, why the like tape recorder is there. There's reason why there's like these kind of scenes in the game. And all these like stories also help you to understand a little bit of this like big picture. And to like give you clues and hints for the like big puzzle of the game. We think consistency is the king. We think that it's really important to have like reason and logic for everything in the world, especially when we ask the player to carefully explore and look at the surroundings for finding clues and hints. And if there are like inconsistencies in the world or some illogical things, it can like break the game and make it like impossible for the player to understand. So we have to be really careful with all the things we put in the game. But we also believe in you, all the players. We think that you are like capable people who are not stupid. So we are not holding your hand. We are not having arrows pointing to next door. We are not kind of having like someone telling you what to think. We give you the setting and then let you explore it. And also play there. If you want to like throw everything in one corner, you can do that. But it's up to you. It's like, well, kind of realistic in a way that quite often there's no one in your head telling you like, yeah, these people were actually drinking here their last mugs of vodka or something. But you go there and you figure these things out yourself. We actually had to make some compromises in there because if we have some, 800 items in the game, we had to highlight important story items and important like items of progression, because it can get really frustrating if the player feels like he has to go through all the items, look inside all the cans, everything. Like, I think there are only 3 people in the world who could play through the game if it was like that. So, small like compromises, highlighting story items, also adding some stuff into the world to explain some things, also adjusting some story bits like to support the gameplay. Yeah, well, puzzles and realism, that's quite interesting because we somehow wanted to make the game world like it's a real place. It has been like research based on the moon. There has been people living, they have been doing some research, and the setting is realistic. Also, there is something like not realistic as we know it. There is something maybe our like science nowadays cannot explain, but the game happens in like kind of alternative reality. But if the doors are locked, there's usually a reason it, and if they can be locked, there's a reason why they can be locked. It's like, okay, there are like a couple of people in a small place, they trust each other because they have to trust each other. Why we have locks in the doors? There has to be a reason for that. And also, example is like, if we have a locked door which requires three keys or three items from you to open, why it requires three keys from different people, and why not, for example, three different things from a single person? Because if you think about this kind of security theory for example, in IT projects or services, you can basically identify people in three ways. It's like what you have, usually it's the keys or like passwords or some, keys, some other items. What you know is like passwords, something else, like what could it be? It's like inside people's head. And what you are, it's like some bio identifying, like fingerprints, something else, voice identification. So there's a reason in the game why there are like three keys, not like three different ways to really make sure that it's real.
Kuuluuko? Okei.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, some of course we want to have some gameplay there, so some keys and items may be hidden in the game world, but when you find them it should be quite obvious why the items were where you found them. Okay, of course it's physics based, or all the like items have like physical qualities, and it's realistic, so yeah, can player exploit physics or bypass some of our locks or puzzles too early in the game? So maybe at some point there was like a couple of boxes blocking away in a corridor. And we thought like, yeah, player has to do some certain thing to get through those obstacles. But when we were doing playtesting, we actually found out that if you take, for example, what was it, like fire extinguisher or oxygen bottle or something, and you throw it to the like boxes 100 times, the boxes slowly move, and then you can get past the thing. So it was really great, it was really fun, but we actually had to think about like, should we encourage this kind of action from the player, or should we kind of prevent it? Should we like fake the physics in a way that you cannot actually exploit it that way? And if the player gets stuck for some reason, who is responsible for that? So if you build like, if you want to get upstairs, and you start building like ladders from books and boxes, and then it all collapses and you get stuck underneath. Who is to blame about this? Like, you get stuck in the game. Well, it's like a lot of things, kind of emergent action, you can't like predict when you are making the game. Well, okay, yeah, last. For now, about these puzzles and realism, before we go more into the virtual reality and puzzle design. Even if the gameplay is very realistic, the game can contain elements which may not be from the reality as we know it. So some things in the game may feel like they are like supernatural or something else, but there's a reason for them, and it's a science fiction game, so there's like somehow they are explained. And well, science fiction, it has like it's based on reality. It has a lot of fiction, science, and scientific like reliability in the game, games and stories and films. But quite often there is also something like really mystical or mythical, like in Space Odyssey 2001. Like, what is that monolith? Yeah. So game world is always a game world. The things that you have in the game world, they should be realistic and have a like place and meaning in that reality. But yeah, in the end, for a couple of slides about puzzles in virtual reality. Of course, this is obvious. We are making virtual reality game. I'm interested in puzzles, so I'm talking about puzzles in virtual reality. But we actually, in Poland, we couldn't use this possibilities of virtual reality that much, because we wanted also the game to be fully playable with normal PC. So there are a lot of like potential puzzles and potential elements in the game and virtual reality that was not used in this production. But I don't know. Hopefully we are going to make another game and another, and then we go deeper and deeper into virtual reality, especially when people buy more and more of these devices, and like making games completely for virtual reality devices is like somehow like good business, or at least a business. But yeah, puzzles and game design change drastically when we go when we do it for virtual reality devices. It's not just like, okay, I have this monitor in front of me, but it's like very immersive audiovisual experience. You are disconnected from reality completely when you have like headphones and like a virtual reality helmet or the head-mounted display. And it's also possible to use like 6 degrees of hand position trackers. So you can have a controller in both of your hands, and you can track the like place and rotation and acceleration of each of those devices into like 3D world, and that changes a lot of the things in games. It's also possible to track your fingers, like what you are doing, like really small movements of fingers. And that also is like a huge opportunity to game and puzzle design. And of course, with some devices, it's possible to move in a space. And I will show you a video here. It's filmed in our, I'm not showing you a video here. Yeah. Yeah, internet connections problems somehow. I was showing you a video about this thing, but yeah, doesn't work. Well, I'm not going to show it. Maybe I can show it afterwards. But yeah, one of guys in our company has made a like demo where he actually uses this HTC Vive hand controllers and the possibility to move in space. I can't remember. Some people have been visiting our office, right? You were. Did you try it out? Did you see it?
No, it was like a half a year, maybe a year ago. So
oh.
Yeah, it wasn't there yet.
Okay, yeah. But yeah, it's quite something. You can actually, when you see that video, you can actually understand like all the possibilities, or at least some of the possibilities we have like with these devices. Well, puzzles in virtual reality. Virtual reality has its like challenges. In-game movement is always challenging to design because there are like really many different ways to move. For example, in current version of Pollen, you can use like the like normal twin sticks moving and turning, beside using your head looking around like this. But you can also turn with the stick, but that can cause some nausea and motion sickness for some people. So you have to have a kind of alternative ways to move into space, and there are ways like teleporting between places. You look at somewhere and press a button, you teleport there. But it kind of breaks the immersion because you are not like actually moving into space. But you have to make some kind of things if you want people to play your game. And also other things like first person, third person, hybrid things are used in some games. But there are literally dozens of different prototypes and ways of movement in the virtual reality. And also there are so many different ways to like track hands and other actions. So you have to basically implement a lot of different things for different devices, like hand controls, fingers, and then you have to think of, like, try it out with everything, because some devices, the accuracy is not that good, and the functionality is not that good as the others. So you have to like figure out what is the like best way to implement the game for as many people as possible. Still, even if we have these challenges and difficulties, we have like possibilities we can't imagine yet. For example, manipulating objects using two hands. I don't know, you can hold an item in your one hand, and then you can use your other hand to like open hatches or rotate some things there, and you can actually look around the objects like it's really something. Just a couple of ideas of what it could be done, like a lot of possibilities there. Positioning yourself in a space to avoid traps. If you can move in the space, you can take a step like side, and then you see that the trap like went off, and then you can continue the game. Also utilizing the stereoscopic vision in distance and scale related puzzles. It can be done, it could be interesting. Or it could be interesting in academic way only. You can use sign languages and spell gestures or something else by finger tracking. So for example, if someone has played Ars Magica role-playing game, it has like finger gestures for throwing spells. And basically you can use those like actual gestures in the game to do spells. And of course, 3D sound directions and distance and puzzles related to that, a lot of interesting possibilities. But this is like really nice, this disconnection from the reality. It's like you are so immersed in the game, you actually can like forget that there can be other people in the same space. So there's a wonderful game called Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes. And the gameplay is like one player is working as a bomb squad member who has a bomb in front of her in a virtual reality. And she has to like tell the other player who has the manual, like, okay, I have this and this kind of puzzle here in the bomb. And the other player reads the manual and tells like, okay, then you have to disconnect the red wire there, and then you have to do this and push that button and everything. So basically you can play co-op games in the same space, but one is using virtual reality and maybe someone the other player is using the printed manual or something. So the kind of we can really utilize the disconnection from the reality in games. But of course, virtual reality requires different level of detail and interactivity. When the player is in the virtual reality world, he really thinks that he or she can press all the buttons and turn all the knobs and everything, if there are such things in the game. And boxes feel more boxy in VR, so if you see like a placeholder box in VR, it's like, oh, no. So you have to have like a quite nice art style and a lot of detail in the game. And also, all the events in the virtual reality, they feel much more intense. So people can get like too excited too easily. And this is not just like horror games, which is, it sounds like horror games in virtual reality. Oh, that's excellent. It's so intense and wonderful. But it's really too intense for quite a lot of people. So if you are planning to make a horror game in a virtual reality, please test it with some other people than yourself also. And also remember that peripheral vision is also an opportunity, but it's also a kind of threat because the players can see more, which is good, and sometimes it can be bad. But yeah, of course, in the future we will incorporate more senses into virtual reality. Maybe the haptic feedback, so like you can feel when you grab items, you can feel it. You are actually holding items in your hand. You can feel their shape. You can feel if they are like solid or soft or cold or warm. It will come first, and then smells and other senses and I don't know will follow before year 2100. So that's the future. Well, of course, it's not just like big VR. When I'm saying big VR, I mean like Oculus Rift, OS VR, like the devices that require you to have like a PC or console. We have already this Google Cardboard, for example. It's like 10 euros at Clas Ohlson. It's made of cardboard. It has two lenses, and when you put your smartphone in, you can get a virtual reality experience from that. Advanced version of that is a Gear VR, which is really wonderful. Unfortunately, I forgot to take one here, but we have been used Gear VR in like game fairs to show people 360 three-dimensional screenshots of pollen while they are waiting their turn to play the game. And it's always wonderful to see people having their first virtual reality experience. They put on the goggles and they're like, whoa, oh, this is so amazing, oh, great. Even with those like really simple and quite cheap devices, we can get like really wonderful feedback from players. And of course, augmented reality is also coming. Kind of sister or brother or some kind of relative of virtual reality. It's like where you add the game or other content over the reality. So it's like see-through lenses where you like project like game data on. For example, Microsoft HoloLens is maybe the next big one to come, but let's see how long it goes. They can get it on like reasonable prices. I think now it's something like thousands of dollars or something, the developer versions. And adding game material on real world imagery changes the reality also into a game. So when you are walking in the street and you get something, you see something in your eyes, you cannot be sure if this is a game or is it a reality. And at some point we have to like think like, can we any more distinct the game from the non-game or reality from virtual reality? And I think quite many of you have seen a lot of films and books and whatever about like which handle this question, like The Lawn Mover Man, for example. Like where a guy transfers to virtual reality and starts to live there. Yeah, okay, summary. All puzzles are lucky action combinations. The order and weight of these elements change the gameplay drastically. Puzzles also have many other dimensions, like they may be open-ended, they may be like clear. They can contain all the information required for gameplay, or they may require the player to explore the reality. to get through the puzzle. Summary, Pollen is a great adventure game designed for VR first, but playable also on normal PC and screen. So when you are thinking about like, should I buy it or not, you don't have to have like Oculus Rift, but you just use your normal PC and you can play our game. Designing puzzles in realistic surroundings and related to a certain story, it's interesting but challenging, and you should always think about like how the puzzle kind of fits into the world, and if you add the puzzle in the game, does it actually change like the player's thoughts of the world itself? Because if the puzzle is like illogical, the player starts to think like, okay, the world is not very like logical also. And virtual reality will offer and already offers many new possibilities to puzzle and game design. And I hope you have a possibility here in Aalto. Maybe you can start exploring these possibilities, make games and puzzles in virtual reality that may not have kind of like commercial potential, but hey, if you can do this, that you should do that right now, because when you have to get some salary from the games you make, you have to also make some compromises on the technologies and content you are making. Yeah, so thank you. And I think, yeah, now if someone has some questions, and I can maybe give you some answers or more questions.
So what are your thoughts on frustration in puzzles? Specifically, is frustration a good thing in a puzzle, and how much frustration? I would think that with VR, since it's more immersive, you want a lot less frustration in your puzzle, but I think in a lot of games that have puzzles, the designers have tried to make them quite frustrating, and what do you think of that?
Yes, excellent question, thank you. So, frustration in puzzles. I think that frustration in games, quite often, it's a bad thing. But there's like, if you think about like Csikszentmihalyi's flow theory, that there's like always the flow channel which borders something like frustration and anxiety and whatever they are. So you should always be or design the games like you are in the like a verge of frustration. But sometimes you have to have these like relief sections where you're just like, okay, this is easy. I had like really difficult puzzle and got through it. So now I can have a couple of easy ones. But building up the frustration when design or solving the puzzle is it's like, I don't know, every player has like their own level of how much frustration they can handle, and that's like a really difficult question, and I think there's no way you can design puzzles that are suitable for all the players. So some players may think like, okay, this was too easy, they get bored, and some players think like, oh, this was too hard, and they get frustrated and they stop playing, and we want to keep players playing the game, and that's why we have to try to avoid like excessive amounts of frustration, and there are like different ways to help this thing. For example, kind of hint systems. At some point, players can ask the game for hints if they feel like they are stuck. The game can offer some hints like, okay, you should try this out or do something like, maybe that points the player some new ideas and new ways to look at
And these kind of hint systems are quite often used in modern adventure games, like in, for example, these Telltale games, Sam and Max, and this Monkey Island series. You can ask someone there for hints, and it tells you something. And also, if you have ever played these escape room games, like I mean, real world escape room games, where you actually go to a room somewhere in Helsinki, for example, and you have 60 minutes time to get out of the rooms. All these like places, they have hint system. There's a guy in the reception. They are looking at watching you in a monitor, and if they feel like you are stuck or if you ask for a hint, they can give you some like some kind of. Excellent. Yeah, so there are ways where you can kind of balance between like too much frustration and enough, but well, you have to implement all those things in the games. Was that good answer?
Sure.
Yeah, I would like to ask about testing. So how do you test puzzles and evaluate how hard they are? And since it seemed you had like 11 people in your team, so of course you have to find people who the puzzles are new to.
Yeah, since all the people in our company, we know the game quite thoroughly, so we are not able to like evaluate the puzzles or the difficulty. So we have had a lot of people coming to our office, play the game, and I'll be sitting beside the people watching what they are doing and making notes, and so we use this kind of external testers, and now we have started also like external beta tests where we send the builds to certain people so they can actually play the game at home, which is nicer place because there's no one sitting there and looking at you all the time and asking you questions, so you can use all the time you want to play the game. But I think the only way to test the puzzles is to actually get people play them and solve them, and then depending on how they kind of do it, you can maybe give them or add some hints in the game or something else. Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Now this seems to work. So who's next there?
Yeah. It works. When I saw this video of Paul, and even before this lecture today, it felt almost like maybe Alien Isolation. Have you played this game? Have you seen it?
No, but I have heard many people saying the same thing.
Yeah, maybe. Well, and the other idea was like, okay, Alien is quite old, serious, and when you create something in science fiction world, you probably make some details, really interesting details, but then after some time it feels so strange, like tape recorders or maybe these cans of soup, or okay, the whole year we are talking about Back to the Future and where the hell are flying cars. So how do you deal with such problems, especially when you talk about reasoning and being logical?
So how we deal with the like scientific problems in storytelling and design.
Yeah, it's mostly about storytelling, yeah.
Pollen happens in kind of parallel universe or parallel history where, Kennedy was not killed in an assassination attempt. So he was able to make a pact with Soviet Union a couple of years after that, and USA and Soviet Union started working together to like conquer the space. And they have a combined space program, and of course that led to some to things that some technologies have developed faster than in our world, but also some technologies have developed a lot slower than in our world. And for example, the game happens in the world year 1995, and tape recorders were still used also in our reality that year. But what comes to other scientific questions, let's just say we do a lot of background research, like reading science articles, science news, following the world. Also, I think most of the people in our company have read like Stephen Hawking's Brief History of Time and some other books also. And then sometimes, for example, when I was designing those, I don't know, you saw this like medical record at some point of the video. I think I used one or two days to like on research of like human brain and hormone systems and the effects of hormones in the like human body and mind. So we want to have this kind of believable aspect in the game, but of course it's still a fiction, and we are not scientists or masters of all the possible areas. So sometimes they can be a bit lazy. Maybe they might not be like really accurate scientifically, but they are accurate enough for people. So if people start googling things they see in our game, they can find like the like basis for all this information and story and puzzles.
Okay, thank you. Actually, it was kind of tricky question, because a few years ago I had a course on fiction, and our teacher used some kind of quote that fiction is a fiction, so it's not a problem. So still we have planes today, but magic carpet is unreachable. Fiction is a fiction.
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
All right, this is a bit of a strange question, but as I was watching that video, a whole lot of sort of scenarios, storytelling-wise, started popping into my head. So how have you dealt with the sort of story that starts building in the player's mind as soon as you are dumped into this world? And yeah.
Yeah, I hope players start building up their own stories, and I think it's really great if people start pondering like what has happened, and they start kind of building their own world on top of our world. Well, we know what has happened in our world. We tell you something about the world, but we let you also work and like use your imagination in this thing. And I think it's really wonderful if people like start thinking like what is means and also maybe telling their own stories of the people in the base, and I hope at maybe some point people start talking about the game on forums and somewhere, and start speculating of different things, and start collecting like the world lore there, and discussing about these elements, and if that happens, I'm really really happy.
Yeah, I have a virtual reality question, because there's this notion that like players never look up in first-person games. Have you noticed in virtual reality, is that still true, or did you have any troubles with like people looking at things like in a different way than you expected, or getting their attention or anything?
When we have been showing our game in different game shows, like I was in England maybe a month ago in EGX, Eurogamer Expo, and we had maybe 200 people trying out Pollen there on virtual reality, and yeah, some people were like really like they got it immediately. They could look around. They did all the possible things they could do in the virtual reality, and used the like HMD really well in exploring the environment. But then there were a lot of people who I think they are like they are so used, like look straight in front of them and playing like this. So they had this like Oculus on their head, and they were going like this and not turning their head at all. And then they were trying to look up, and they were using the stick, and we are like, no, look up. I'm trying. No, look up. It's like, ah. Then they look up, and then they continue like this. So it's really different way of experiencing the game and looking at items. So I think it takes some time for some people to like get used to the, like the fact that you can actually turn in on your chair and look around and maybe do this and look under the table and so on.
Yeah. Thanks.
Are you waiting? I could ask one question. Sure. So yeah, you already mentioned this room escape games, which I actually tried for the first time just last week, and found
which
that very.
Where were you?
This was in Prague.
Ah.
But yeah, it's interesting to, because I could imagine like those possibilities of VR could be somehow already seen in that kind of actual real world setting when you're bodily there.
The room escape, it's like virtual reality. It's artificial surroundings, and you are doing some really artificial things to get out of the room. So
yeah, even though you can't, of course, play with the physics or you know this sort of stuff. But it would be nice to hear some more thoughts. Have you been doing those, and like has that somehow affected, given you ideas or anything?
Yeah, I've been through four different rooms in Helsinki. Didn't get out in time for the first two times, but then we got out, and last Saturday I went there also, and we almost made like record time, 38 minutes to get through the KGB room. They are definitely really interesting. But they feel like games. They are made for the player, because the like puzzles there, they couldn't. There's no reason why they exist in the real world. Why should you have like strange, like I don't know, locks everywhere and paintings with hinges and so on? But as a game experience, they are really fun and with like good people, nice people you know well. It's really nice to go there and start working together. It's a really wonderful collaborative experience. And I definitely think I would love to make those games. And I would actually love to make those room escape games also in virtual reality. And I'm pretty sure that in maybe next year there will be plenty of those games in the market, because I'm pretty sure also that I'm not the only one who has this idea.
So, talking about room escapes, if Pollen succeeds, would you like to make in real world Pollen like this room escape, maybe somewhere in Helsinki?
Mm. Of course, I would like to make it.
Is it possible?
I don't know. I think it might be possible. It would require a lot of space and also a lot of time from the players also. But it would be possible. And it's kind of a nice idea that we could make like a room escape game that is somehow like part of Pollen world. Maybe not the whole Pollen experience, but some part of it as a like real world experience. It's a nice idea. Maybe it's not happening, but I will think about it tonight when I go to sleep.
Oh. Hi, so I have a question about the virtual reality kind of headsets. A lot of people experience nausea when they have them on. How did you as a team kind of like design around that, or did you do anything different?
Actually, most of the virtual reality development was done before I already before I got to the company, but I've heard quite a lot about like war stories about how, what people have been doing, and the virtual reality is really interesting right now because the consumer devices are not on the market yet, and basically there is not a market for games yet. It will start next year. So there's no best practices. There are a lot of like different models, different theories, different ways to do things. People have tried out different things, and I think the virtual reality community is quite open and they share a lot of their thoughts. We have a lot of videos of different ways to move in virtual reality and so on. But I think we have found kind of good balance in the moving inside the game, and that includes like slow enough movements and a lot of like things the player actually can adjust in the game. You can adjust like acceleration of turning and moving, and I don't know, there are a lot of things there. But we are also going to have a couple of different ways to move. For example, now we have this like twin stick movement where you actually walk around in the world. But I think we are going to implement also some kind of teleporting system where you don't move, you just jump to other places. Because the motion sickness comes from this like acceleration and movement, and your eyes tell you different than your like balance sense, then it's like you have kind of disconnection there, and that makes you feel nausea. So I think if you are making a virtual reality game, you have to have at least a couple of different options for moving in the world, and a lot of different ways to adjust the movement for the player.
Thank you.
I also want to add here that quite many people, when they try out virtual reality for the first time, they can get this like motion sickness, but you acclimatize, you get used to that thing when you like use the virtual reality, for example, every day for 15 minutes or something like that. It takes maybe a couple of weeks, and I'm pretty sure most of the people can, after that kind of treatment, most of the people can play through the pollen with a virtual reality headset.
Yeah, but do you think like when VR starts to become like mainstream, in the beginning, of course, some the people will want to play like in VRs, but then every day coming from the work, really tired, people will like, okay, let me take these goggles and headphones, or will be like just, oh, I'll play just on my computer and start to leave aside the virtual reality gadgets?
I don't think virtual reality is going to be like new mobile phones. It's something that, at least for the next 50 years, not everyone is going to have a virtual reality device. But when we have these kind of like really cheap, entry-level devices, people can start like trying this out every now and then. And then when the market grows, we can make better content for the devices, and also the devices themselves, they get better. So I'm pretty sure that in maybe 10 years, we are going to have millions of like big VR devices in the market. And that starts to be quite, I don't know, maybe that's a mainstream thing then. Or maybe it's not. Maybe mainstream means that you have to have a billion things, but that's not going to happen really quickly.
Hi. having to do with the previous question a bit, and virtual reality, with not everyone wanting to change their living room to accommodate for the VR and buying specialist hardware, there's the possibility that arcades will make a comeback, and it'll be more like not something that you want to play every day, but occasionally you'll go in to some VR hall somewhere and pay for one session and that kind of thing. Do you think that would change designing the experiences?
Yes, that will definitely happen, because I think virtual reality can really be kind of like, I don't know, attraction. You go there every now and then and do something really fancy with your friends for half an hour or 1 hour or something. And I think there already are some kind of like virtual reality using experiences somewhere in the world. And of course, I think if you're making these kind of like kind of once in a lifetime experiences or like really wow experiences, you have to also design the games for that experience, because, well, you know, people are coming there for 15 minutes, you have to make the game, or 5 minutes, you have to make the game to be playable for 5 minutes and not like Pollen, which takes, I don't know, 8-10 hours or something. Yes, it will change, or yeah, you have to like make the like content for those special places. Unless, of course, you can think like back in the days, I don't know anymore, but we had these internet cafes where people can go. There were computers, you can get to internet in a certain place. It's possible that we actually can have these like VR cafes where you can go and use the VR device for some time, like, and pay for €5, €10 an hour or something like that. And in those places, it's like okay that you actually have these like mainstream common marketplace games and content.
Well, it feels also intriguing, this discussion about VRs and like Oculus Rift and arcades. I think in the 90s, maybe even earlier, there were already some kind of virtual reality. I can't remember, was it Sega virtual reality or something, but they didn't ever succeed.
Nintendo Virtual Boy was, yep, at least, yeah.
Probably, yeah. So how do you think, is it going to be the same thing again these days, or technology is just so developed that it won't happen?
Do you want to hear like a historical review of of the VR? Because, well, okay, I remember my first virtual reality experience was back in, I don't know, maybe it was 1988 or something, in a science park in Oulu, where they had this virtual reality device where you actually sit down and then you have this like rigid helmet system that comes on your like eyes, and then you can look around there, and then you had I think it had a joystick or something there. And the resolution was really bad, and the frame rate was something like one frame every 2 seconds or something. And I was like, all right, is this the future? No, no. And I have been quite skeptical about like the virtual reality, because I had that experience. They tried to get the virtual reality to mainstream already in the early 90s, or maybe even earlier. But it was that the technology was not ready back then. It was too expensive, it was not good enough. And so people were thinking like, oh, this is crap. It's never going to happen. And I think in 1999 or something, there were maybe 10,000 virtual reality devices in the world, mostly in kind of research centers and somewhere else. But now, well, actually, every one of us has that like a device in our pocket. You can actually use your like smartphone as a like virtual reality device of some sort. And now we are in a situation that, well, it can be like really, you can actually do stuff. You don't have to spend like 65,000 euros. You don't have to like have a like huge hall or whatever, and all these devices and some supercomputers, because now the technology is good enough for like the basic level of virtual reality experiences. And I think now it's going to break. It's going to be quite big, and I think if it was not going to be big, then why all the big players like Sony, Valve, Google, Facebook are actually doing it? We have like the couple of the biggest companies in the world doing this right now. So it's definitely going to happen on some level now on.
If we don't want it, they'll make us to want it.
Yes.
Hello. I was just I have done a VR workshop on filming for VR, and there's a lot of people into that, and now JJ Abrams and Ridley Scott are producing also some movie for VR. And what do you think about VR in cinema?
I think it will change the role of author, because when you are making like normal cinema or film, you can like control the focus, way the people look around and where to look and all these like things. But when you are making like virtual reality film or cinema, you cannot control everything. There might be people can look around. I don't know. Maybe at some point they can move around in the world. Director or the maker of the film, it kind of loses control of the content, and I think that's interesting, but it also kind of it has some artistic problems there. So I don't know. I haven't thought about this virtual reality cinema. I'm pretty happy with this. That's quite traditional cinema, especially film. But well, I don't have really strong opinions on that. Yeah, sorry.
So, Jaakko, thanks a lot. Let's give a big applause. That's good, and also well done. Lots of questions. It's great to have some conversations like this, and thus I will also invite you again to have some refreshments now if you have the time, and continue the discussion. And also, of course, our next lecture is now coming up already in 2 weeks. So usually it's about once in a month, but now because Christmas is approaching and we still have to put 2 lectures in, the next one is quite soon. So in 2 weeks, on the 9th of November, Karoliina Korpo will be here giving the next lecture. So stay tuned for that too. But thanks for today. Please come with us there. I hope the list of attendants is somewhere. Please bring it to me. And if somebody hasn't signed, then do it. See you in 2 weeks. Thank you.
Yeah. Kiitos. Tää meni.
Sehän meni.
2 tuntia oikein.
Okay. Joo.
Omia, että oli kysymyksiä niin paljon.
Kyllä.
Tänä vuonna näyttää sitä, että jengi uskaltaa kysyä.
Joo.
Positiivista.
Joo. Toivottavasti oli mielenkiintoista asiaa myös.
Joo. Mulla oli hyvin mielenkiintoista, kun on toi just tätä puhuttaa.
Oletko ihan jotain
paperia tai muuta miettinyt vai ihan
en mä nyt ihan niin pitkällä vielä lähinnä.